Hello, good morning. Welcome everyone to the second panel discussion of Talking Galleries Berlin. As you know, Talking Galleries is a platform for art gallerists and art professionals. Our main intention is to discuss, reflect, and make new knowledge around the issues and challenges that the art gallery practices is facing nowadays. Before I introduce you briefly to the panel discussion of today, I will have to say a few things. First, German translation is available. If you see that desk on your left-hand side, you can find headsets for those of you who feel more comfortable having the translation into German. Second, after the talk, you are able to use that big gray entrance in order to get to the art fair. Yesterday was a little bit of a mess, so they told me to ask you kindly to use that entrance in order to get to the fair. So today's panel is entitled How to Grow with Your Artists, Different Gallery Models. We believe artists are the main asset for galleries, and that's why we wanted to have different galleries coming from different backgrounds, different geopolitical contexts, in order to discuss these issues. Moderating, we have invited Chus Martínez. Chus, thank you very much for having accepted this invitation. Chus has a long career as curator, as many of you know, and Chus wanted me to highlight the fact that she recently opened a beautiful exhibition in Argentina. It was called The Metabolic Age at the Malba, an institution also directed by a Spanish curator and director, Agustín Pérez Rubio. Chus Martínez is nowadays the director of the Institute of Art at the FHNW Academy of Art and Design in Basel. And Chus Martínez has been the chief curator of institutions such as the MACBA in Barcelona and the Museo del Barrio in New York. As speakers, we have Victor Gisler. Victor, thank you also for having accepted our invitation. Victor Gisler has a background in economics. He founded the gallery May 36 back in 1987. It means that he has been involved for 25 years or more working with an international roster of artists and working in a close relationship with them. Victor, we believe, is a connoisseur of the international art circuits, and we believe also that he moves quite well in those circuits. Then we have Lukasz Gorczyca. Lukasz, thank you also for accepting our invitation. Lukasz is an art historian and co-founder of the Raster projects, the Raster Gallery, the Raster Magazine, and also Villa Raster. Lukasz, we want to highlight the fact that besides or beyond the gallery, he has been involved in producing and co-producing projects outside the gallery, such as the Villa Raster project or the Raster magazine. He's been also involved in writing a lot about art. And also Jochen Meyer. Jochen, thank you also for accepting our invitation. Jochen is the co-founder of the gallery Meyer Riegger. I'm sorry, my German is inexistent. He co-founded this gallery in 1997 in Karlsruhe, and then he moved the gallery to Berlin. I think this is an important asset that we should highlight. Jochen has been also very active in collaborating with colleagues in projects such as the Berlin Gallery Weekend and ABC. So I think we have, as I said before, different backgrounds and different approaches towards the gallery practice. So thank you very much all, and just please.
Yeah, first of all, thank you for inviting me to moderate, and thank you for coming in such a sunny, beautiful day in Berlin. And we are here to address a topic which is an obvious but a complex one, which is how to grow together with your artists, or how to support your artists when you are working in the context of a gallery. A gallery is a very complex interaction of social, political, economic, and aesthetic relations in the middle of a complex world, which is the production and the consumption and the exhibition of art. And these complex relationships are also determined by the context, a specific context in which the galleries are, which differ greatly from country to country, and they are also determined by many things, you know, legal, taxes, how every country, how every context actually kind of ambitions this economical activity. So inside this, you have a personal relationship with the artist and the gallerist, but also now we are living in a very specific moment, which I think is quite unprecedented. So 10 years ago, we would probably not have this conversation in the same terms as we are having them now. We will talk about how a gallerist choose an artist to be represented, and you would assume that, of course, once you are working with a gallerist, you are in a continuous dialogue with this gallerist, and actually they, in a private manner, determine the type of relationship that they do have, and this relationship is less public than it is today. Why is today this topic more public than it was, for example, 10 or 15 years ago? 10 or 15 years ago, probably the public money was also playing an enormous role as determining, as being the commissioner of many of the artworks that were presented in some of the exhibitions. For example, in some countries, like in Spain, but in Italy, I think it was the same. In Germany, it's a little bit different. In France, it's kind of the same as well. When you are in a context like an art fair, like today, there is a number of the people which are the collectors buying the art pieces, but a number of the money coming from the state was also buying in the art fairs. It was some public money as well, investing in buying for the public collections. Today, this is kind of not happening anymore. When a biennial was produced, actually the money coming from the budget of the biennial was there to produce new pieces for the artists invited. And this is also kind of being reduced. It was an article, quite very intelligent one, about the last Istanbul biennial in which I was involved, that was actually questioning this kind of commissioning model. The fact that some of the artists invited, the production of the artworks was not pay by the money of the biennial, but was kind of through the context of collectors, and actually the galleries were the ones producing the artworks. So this relationship of this growing with the artist is also growing with a context that is really radically changing. And I would like to start this panel by asking you, how do you actually perceive that? And also, it's probably a very complex internal dialogue when you have curators or people in your gallery invited to shows, and actually you are confronted with the idea that you need, or if this artist should or should not participate, then part of the production needs to be paid by the gallery, and also in how far this also stabilizes or destabilizes the internal relations with other artists in the gallery, or the question on how this relationship with the artist that you are producing a piece for a particular show, for example, also produces a new relationship with the collectors, because the collectors automatically see that particular artist is having a certain appeal for a certain exhibition, the piece is produced, and then it creates an idea that perhaps they can also support and then get the price reduced because of the production support and so on and so forth. So this is, I think, a kind of new situation, and I would like you to perhaps reflect upon this kind of the change in these relationships with your own artists in the last decade, if you could. Perhaps, Victor, you could start, and then we do it around the clock.
Okay, good morning, everybody. As you learned, I started in the mid-80s, and when you look back at the time and you look at the program I stay for today, 80% are the same artist. Thomas Ruf, I started my first show in 88 with him, he's now a famous German artist. It was a different time, we could stay through. It's a people-to-people business, we show, tell and sell, it was much smaller. Today, and this is why this discussion is very interesting, today the various hats, the passion of a gallerist we wear, has added to another hat, which is really how we manage the artist production in the global situation of today, where the visibility is almost everything. I not only mean the visibility of the piece in a show or in the gallery, it's also the visibility in social media, the visibility in written medias everywhere. And we had seen since, I would say, the mid-90s, especially in America, a growing gallery system where the galleries became extensively large with very good staff for different structures, or the different heads I use as a metaphor. And this is getting more and more and more now. And for middle galleries like me, we try, of course, to meet colleagues who have similar problems. We share the problems and then try to sort of become a partner with it in the production. The same thing, of course, happens with the collector, because we know them also. They were approached by a curator. Then, of course, the artist, if we don't know him, the artist introduces him to us. Then you start the discussion how he could help and how in the long run, if the work becomes available for the art market, how his shares in the production when the sale is happening are covered. And this makes it even more complex, because it's another role. You know, the producer or the collector is a co-producer, and of course it becomes a little bit sort of overlapping, and that certainly doesn't make the things easier if you imagine an exploding art market for an artist. You know, that suddenly, let's say, the piece average was maybe supported by 200,000, and normally the artwork in the market would be, let's say, 300,000 for a bigger piece, or 400,000, and the market would demand 1.5 for 2 million. That makes even the collector thinking twice, what's going to happen if he should produce more, or how the situation is. So I see it only that with connoisseurship amongst the galleries and the people we can hire to make the gallery larger, we can handle all these facts. And I see at this very moment that there is a change going around the globe in terms of the size a gallery has to have to fulfill all these demands, in a way, and beside the fairs where we are here. And one is, which I don't have in the gallery, is this artist liaison. Like, there are people, they are hired in galleries, larger galleries, they only deal with, let's say, a group of artists from the gallery. And it's about everything. It's the communication, it's the production, it's the relationship to the curators, to the collectors. It's something on a smaller scale many of my colleagues have done for their lifetime, but now this becomes like in a bigger scheme, this becomes like a real profession in a way, and gets more and more professionalized, because that's the demand, as you were describing it with the financial part from the Biennales, because that becomes a demand. So the larger galleries can fulfill that demand easier than a smaller gallery.
Lukasz?
So my experience is, of course, slightly different, because we started in a bit different context, politically and economically. So that was from the very beginning. There was, of course, the question how to develop relations and the production issues with the institutions. And what I learned is that we need to be very, very flexible, because most of the cases are individual. So actually, I noticed that within the last couple of years, it costs us more and more work and time actually to negotiate different practices, different individual productions, because every single case, cooperation with the institution or the Biennale is different. It started, I remember, that was kind of difficult for me, I think, at Manifesta 2008 in Italy. So if I'm not wrong, that was the first time they introduced the idea of the patron program during the process of productions, calling the local collectors and offering them to cover the cost of the production of the piece for the Biennale, and committing to buy it. But then there was really like an unusual situation because these producers from the part of Biennale proposed the very simple deal that that the collector would pay, I think, 1/3 over the production cost. So which means the price was somehow calculated after the production cost, not after the position of the artist on the market, for example. So that was, it caused many, many problems. Of course, the galleries need to be out of these deals, so all the money went to the artists and to the Biennale back, and it provoked such a long discussions, and many troubles. It was really, really very difficult, and that was the moment I understood that the situation is really changing, and we need to be very, very flexible. And it is like now that we spent really a lot of time to negotiate every case like that, every production like that, which makes us more now like I don't know, somebody like a real producer or manager, some like in a film industry. You rather think about how to, as you say, how to approach other fellow galleries to make, to produce something together, for example, how to share it then, to negotiate with the museum, how to deduct the production cost. So it's completely different type of organization. So we are less like dealers and more like a really kind of managers or producers trying to put all the things, all the puzzle together. So it's exciting at the same time.
Do you know about the crowdfunding? Did they already start that?
Really?
No? The crowdfunding for an artist piece to make. I could see that you, you know, help to produce a piece for the biennial through all of us in here, just because we like the idea, like crowdfunding.
Something to discuss.
We just sold,
Jochen?
Did you?
Yeah, we just sold an artwork after a crowdfunding campaign.
Wow.
Here to the Berlin Museum, uh-huh, to the Neue Nationalgalerie by Jonathan Monk, and it was a big campaign. So the museum wanted to acquire a piece by Jonathan, and but they were lacking out of budget, so they started this crowdfunding campaign over 6 months, and after 6 months they finally had the money together to acquire the work. But it's interesting what you said, Lukasz, because I have exactly the same experiences. When one of our artists is invited to, let's say, Venice Biennial or Manifesto or other non-commercial exhibitions, we are, from the first moment, involved in a commercial discussion, because the piece that is going to be shown at the Biennial shall be a new piece. Often we work, for example, with a lot of artists who are working with film, so production costs are high. So we have to decide with the artist on how to finance the production for that specific participation. Then it's often the case that we are always talking about that works are already sold once they've been exhibited at the Biennial. I don't think that this is the case with every artist and with every piece, because especially if you have, let's say, a strong curatorial focus in the gallery, you sometimes work with artists who are not necessarily always commercially working on the market. So it's not a non-commercial market, but the Biennial expects from you that you finance the piece. And this goes easily, if it's a film artist, into like a budget of 40,000-50,000 euros. And so what can you do? I mean, on one side, you talk to the potential few collectors who are still interested in collecting, let's say, more intellectual works, like 35mm films or something like that, to finance a production with them. But the production price is, of course, not the same price as the sales price. Mm-hmm. So you generate already a difference from the beginning. And that's, of course, a big problem. I mean, what we always do, both of you have said that, we collaborate with our colleagues. I'm a strong believer in collaboration, in partnerships, that galleries working with artists together, that they collaborate and really like develop a plan on financing things. But it's not only about the financing, of course. We have other things all to fulfill within the expectations of the artists, where galleries can be stronger partners if they collaborate amongst each other.
So perhaps, I don't know if the audience, if you are familiar with this question that we are addressing, I think, because it's a crucial one right now. The fact that you are not only supporting your artists in terms of personal support, because you are the one representing them, but galleries more and more are becoming the producers of some of the shows that we publicly see because of another problem that is the lack of public funding. So the lack of public funding, which is a crucial problem, is producing an internal kind of debate, because perhaps you don't know it, but for example, you create, I think Lukasz was referring to it, so there is absolutely no budget to produce new art pieces. You are supposed as a curator to do a show. So the budget that normally is provided pays more or less for the venue. I'm just, you know, generalizing, summarizing a situation that you can understand as an audience what you are actually watching. So you are watching a public budget that pays for the electricity, for the rent, for the security, and sometimes even for the transport, and there is very few money left to produce new pieces. And then the question in this kind of shows is that you are invited to see a new production of art, because that is different from the museums, and this is different from what you normally see at the galleries. So this kind of difference is actually determined by the fact that the pieces are new. The pieces respond to a particular moment in a curatorial discourse, they respond to a particular site, to a particular political context. So this newness is necessary. On the other hand, nobody has the money to pay for the newness, and we kind of want all of us, galleries, collectors, patrons, the public money, the curators, you want to preserve this possibility. So sometimes the patrons do, you manage more or less, that the patrons associate themselves and they support the production of several pieces, but then as Jochen was referring to and Lukasz, the next problem is that some artists are represented by two or more galleries. So the moment comes after how to agree who is making the sale and how to actually share the benefits that this sale is. So this kind of legal, contractual, and this new network of interactions did change a lot in the last 10 years. But then I want to go back to it, to the prototypical question when it comes to the relationship in between galleries and artists. I think also some years ago, for example in Germany, to give a local example, very beautiful and new art pieces were produced by a semi or medium-sized institutions called Kunstvereine. So the Kunstvereine did not have lots of money, but they did always have money enough to invite an artist to produce new pieces. And then the result that you would see in the Kunstvereine, which is a huge network that is present and was very active, not anymore, in the whole German territory, you were then confronted, for example, with new pieces by younger generation that not necessarily would have the character of a piece that you would encounter in a collection of an institution or in an art gallery. They have a complete different character because they were responding, let's say, to the particular wish of the artist in that moment. When the money fails, when this situation is not possible anymore, nobody has actually the money to produce these pieces or not to produce them in the same character, or you need to produce them so with the backstage in your mind that you better do them so that you can sell them, because otherwise there's absolutely not money flow into this kind of circumstance. The next question is in how far galleries are or not responsible for modifying the less experimental character, let's put it blunt, to the art production. So how do you see that? I think, how do you deal when an artist wants to do something that you already know that the market is gonna have serious difficulties in absorbing?
I mean, we consider ourselves as partners of the artists, and theoretically, ideally, we support whatever the artist wants to do. I mean, we are not thinking about the sale that is at the end, after the production, after the exhibition. It's more about a good representation of the artist with his work in an exhibition. And I also strongly believe that in the end, you can sell every piece of art as long as it's good.
Yeah, it's a beautiful idea. Yeah. I mean, we need to count money as well. So, I mean, of course, this is ideal situation that we can let the artist work whatever he or she wants to do in the gallery. So, but so we our strategy is somehow that we invest some money for the show, for the production of the works for the shows at our space, because we are interested to have a really good show in the gallery. So this is the priority somehow. If you like to really invest money even for the works which are not meant to be commercial, really. So we go for that, but first in our space. This is the priority. And then there are, of course, the many situations, many different options. One of them is that we already also try, that was even proposed by the artist, that we invest money for like a kind of ambitious show, but instead of that, we are getting from the artist another piece for us to our inventory. We can theoretically sell more easily, right? So this is sort of like also idea of really sharing this cost in a way. Artist is of course not really putting money on the table, but it's giving the piece, which it's also then easier for us because we can maybe refund it.
Ideas you have to help to come to life, and we are partners with the artist. And if it's not the situation where I see the artist is so frustrated, he wants to throw out a chunk of money and sort of make something where I would say stupid, you go for it. And as you were saying, in the long run, you know, it's a give and take, and things come back. And if you understand you as a program gallery, and you work with this artist, and this artist may have a difficult or even, I would say, a radical position, you better go with it. Otherwise, you should not choose to work with this mind, because this is what your passion keeps going, and you're trying to help that this ideas comes to life. And if you don't have your own money, you try to find someone you can sort of pursue or somehow to try to get into that deal and help that the idea comes through. And later on, of course, what you describe comes to problem, mm-hmm. how you recapitalize. But
right.
We've gone through that so many times.
We are addressing here a really important issue, which is like you are implying that even if the gallery is an economic enterprise, you as a gallery puts in the forefront the support. So you are the producers of ideas, and you actually are there to support the wish. And as Lukasz was saying, you are prepared to kind of commute or transfer an idea that is perhaps unsellable versus a work that is not exhibited, but it is sellable. So this kind of more backstage running business versus the gallery as a showroom for a more bold, a more daring idea, which I believe it's true many times, but is also untrue the same amount of times, because all of us, we have been in galleries, mostly big, some of them very well known, where the artists even talk about it, where you enter into the room and you automatically see that the works accommodate the collector's eye. Not only the collector's eye is present in the gallery, but probably I think that this new transformation is even happening in exhibitions. You go to public exhibitions, even to public institutions, and then you see the collector's eye. The collector's eye is a very particular eye. It's an eye that does not arrange things in terms of ideas or in terms of chronology or in terms of conceptual, not necessarily conceptual concerns, but it's a different desire. And this desire has many, many paths, many, many forms, some of them intriguing, some of them super interesting, but it's a desire that is different sometimes than other desires, than the historical desire of a collection, the curatorial desire, the experimental desire, and so on and so forth. So there is a pressure as well. So the question is how you are doing, like you are kind of living a double life. You need to educate both the artists or support the artists in what you were saying, go for it, do it. And you need to respond to the collector and say, this is also what you should do. If you want to collect, you need to distinguish like three types of families, because we are talking sometimes about collecting art without distinguishing the other two families. There is like the people that buy art, then there is art investors, and then there is art collectors. And these kind of three types are kind of different. So how do you deal with this education? How do you educate people into looking at things that they, you know, there is no place in my living room for them, or I don't understand, why should I collect something that is almost invisible, or it's just an idea, but I cannot show it to anybody, or things like that. So how do you deal with that?
I think you are somehow referring to the ideal situation where you can really divide and call the person collector, the another person being investor. But there is also, in this system, there's also one eye missing, which is like a curator's eye. And this is also the part of the market, actually, institution. So if you produce the show, that will be really very, very limiting to address it only to the so-called collector's eye, right? So we have like many projects and many shows we think are just great projects, and we do that, and we think we should immediately approach the institution. And luckily, there are still like many institutions that are they run the acquisitions program. So for us, actually, we that was even from the very beginning. The ambition was somehow rather to place the works in the public collections, right?
But I think that this is really important what you are saying, because this is really context oriented. For example, I just quote the case of Spain because it's very similar to the case of Poland. In Spain, because of the tax law and because of an historical circumstance, the civil society mostly thinks that it's not the duty to collect, and collect in such a way that they actually give the works in permanent loan to the state collections. It should be the institution, through the budget, which is assigned by the state, that should collect. Therefore, some of the galleries, when they produce thinking of a state collection. If you go to the United States of America, nothing of this is the case, because for them, there is no other thing but trustees. And the trustees are those that constitute the public institutions, and the public institution are money architecture, economical architecture. So it is them that are the addressees. So this transformation of who are you addressing, which in Poland, like in Spain, was for many years the state. You were kind of doing as if it could be part of a state collection. This is also kind of being transformed, because now this money disappeared in Spain completely, in other contexts less completely, but even in Germany it used to be bigger than it is. And it changed because of a mentality that is publicly saying that it should be a hybrid. Even if the state would have the money, it's better not to assign the money to the institutions, but to enter into a negotiation with the public society and collectors to do that. So they prefer that. So perhaps Jochen?
Yeah, I can only agree also what Lukasz said. The question is, who is the audience? Who are we addressing as galleries with our exhibitions? And of course, we are addressing collectors on all different levels, as you said. But we are also addressing, let's say, the critical mass. We are also addressing the curators, because if a curator is, after a presentation in the gallery, doing an exhibition with the artist in institutional context, it helps for the artist's career. We are addressing the writers, because if there is a kind of discourse about the artist, we are also helping the artist's career. The whole package together makes an artist's career and also helps to make sales possible. I strongly believe whatever we are doing also in our joint events like Gallery Weekend, which is from the first side, it's a very commercial event because it's a weekend where galleries are putting up probably their best exhibitions in the year to make like a very good sales moment for them. We are not only addressing the collectors, we are also addressing the creators on the same level, we're also addressing the writers, we're also addressing other artists, because it's the whole amount of the perception of an exhibition that makes an artist's career going, and it's very important to support at that level. On the other side, I think it's very difficult to educate collectors who are buying for a private context to, let's say, acquire a performance piece. It's almost impossible. For if you're working with a performance artist, you only have the chance to work with a public institution.
Curiosity is the word. If you have somebody, no matter if he wants to buy something to put on the wall, if he starts to ask, you know he's curious. And then you go in and you might convince. I mean, I've been working since 30 years almost with Lawrence Wiener. You think he's a master today, but this is not sellable. Like, you know, but there are people say, you know, huh, this looks interesting. How is this working? What do I get? And then you start the whole discourse, and the mama and the papa culture has gone, is away, because there's no object, but there can be an object. So you start completely on a different level. And if this is a captain of industry who understands what he did in a production with an idea, and he's curious, and he's collecting, he knows this is damned interesting. I don't care if I don't have an object on the wall. I can do an object with it, because it's a sculpture, I can make it. It's the curiosity. And of course, that's all the beginning and the ending. You know, if the people come to you in the gallery or in an art fair and they don't show the curiosity to look at the work and to ask, let's just go by, let's say, by the price maybe, or they see it because they know what it is because of the name, it's a different level. But once they start, you go in, and as Jochen perfectly described, on the more sophisticated level, if we have to talk with a collector who is almost an institutional collector, of course, the curators and the critics is everything, you prepare that the information goes there, and maybe the piece can end up in such a surrounding. And it's always a great challenge to have somebody going for something he doesn't know. Like a chef, you know, if you're trying to do some great Turkish food and people say, oh, Turkish food, you know, and then they had it and they say it's fantastic, you know, and then they will tell it to the other people. It's what you know and what you don't know. The curiosity keeps it going.
Since we are approaching 12, I'm going to kind of go polemic. We are talking about the relationship in between galleries and artists, and we are talking about production, we are talking about the relationship of inside this production and the collectors and the different groups and the institutions and the public money, and we are kind of addressing the transformation of this private but very important group of people that are kind of in a constant dialogue inside at the core of the art wall, which are this dialogue happening in the galleries. But then, if you look at the programs of your own galleries, there is, to the contrary of what the reality tells us, a very moderate number of women present in your galleries, for example, in your programs. And we are facing, again, a really interesting transformation. Artists and galleries are not only buying or supporting living artists, but they are buying states. So now, what's happening is that some of the galleries are buying the states of dead artists to preserve it and also to be able to, you know, both to be able to sell it and to be able to study it sometimes. Some, even a large amount of those states which are available because they are still cheap to buy, are those of women artists. Because at the same time that if you go to the shows and to the galleries and you see not only a big and large and beautiful and qualitative amount of women artists working, you do see still very few of those shows present in public institutions. I think Germany is actually a very bad example. In other countries, it's a little bit better, but it's in average kind of not the same amount. In the galleries, it's kind of the same. And as I said, you see support or kind of big support of women artists in the upcoming years, then some sort of silent in the mid-career, and a new interest when they grow older. And when they die, it's great, because there is an impressive amount of already produced work that is unrepresented, that has no value market yet, and it's a fantastic material for speculation. So I'm being polemic here, but it is happening. I remember, you know, meeting Nancy Spero, and we did a big and beautiful exhibition of Nancy Spero at Magba. And yeah, I think she was almost unrepresented. Or there is like fantastic German artists that are really having solo shows in the States, like for example Andrea Butner, but she has no German gallery. Or you have people like many. There is many and many and many. So in how far this relationship with the artist includes this internal education and a relationship in a larger sense of it, like including women in the program, working with them. We know the market, if you are a woman artist, the work is cheaper, at least by 20%. And this is a debate that is happening now. You know, you could put it in parallel what is happening in the movies. No, everyone knows this kind of new wave of actresses talking and complaining that they are less paid than actors. But it's in the office, it's at home, and it's also in the art market. So I would like you to say something about this. Possibilities that do galleries have to transform that situation and to actually start new relationships with this question of gender?
It's now we should as galleries take not only responsibility for financial part of the production but also intellectual one, right?
So no, not it's really. Like, no. Let's be polemic. You don't need to. There is the same quality. So yeah. It's not about positive discrimination. I'm talking about amazing artists. Yeah. So if there is the same amount of quality in the male and the female wall, there is in the programs still a tendency to represent more male, and this tendency has to do with the market. Mm-hmm. They sell expensiver. I mean, so, and there is...
I would have to do the math in my program, but I think that 50% of our artists are women, nearly, or even more, I don't know. I would have to count them, and a lot
I
of...
count them, you count. It's not 50%.
But it's...
almost, but it's not.
It's almost, okay.
No, because I'm polemic, it's almost yeah. 12. Yeah. It needs to be.
Okay, and many of these female artists are really having like a feministic position in their artwork.
No, but imagine, I think, I'm not talking here about ideology. I'm not talking about feminism. I'm mm-hmm. talking about a woman artist, like an artist mm-hmm. that is born woman. So it's and that can do things
so,
like that look as if
so
you are watching.
I think we're on the
no,
same
imagine,
page.
You look at the work and it looks like the male artist. It's only that you approach it and how much does it cost? And then you say, how is this guy called? How is the painter's name? Mm. And then it's like Sarah Morris, you know? And mm-hmm. so mm-hmm. and then... So I'm not talking about feminism or politic or mm-hmm. engagement. I'm talking mm-hmm. about art production.
Mm-hmm. I understand. I think everything you said is right, except of that my personal experience in working with my artist is different because I make no difference between men and women artists. For me, it's the same. So it's very difficult for me to say something out of my personal experience in working as a gallerist with my artist, and for me it's the same.
Even the pricing we did.
The pricing, I would not have ever even considered to make a different price for a women artist.
No, it's not a different price that you make. I'm talking about the market. I'm not talking about the galleries. The, mm-hmm. the galleries don't set the market price. Uh-huh. It's only that collecting women art people is cheaper. So this is a fact. Mm-hmm. But the quality and the outstanding quality of the woman artist is there.
That's
but
there, yeah.
There is, in the programs, and if you go to ARFERS, there are reasons why when you go to the BUSES, there is less women than men. Mm-hmm. And it's not quality what is the reason. And it's also not that the fact that all galleries are misogynist, so we are not talking about that. We are talking about how to adapt better to a reality that is already there.
But it's already changing, I guess, right? So after like a really strong engagement of the institutions, for example, to support, to rediscover the women artists, also like persons that were really overlooked, this is really growing interest on the market as well, and the galleries are following that. This is like a very simple mechanism. So you do, as institutions, you do education, and the market is following that. So it's changing. If you will count this percentage, let's say 20 years ago, would be really much harder, right? So I think like we are somehow on the good way. I mean, we are improving.
Even in the gallery, if you have a male or a female artist, people look at the work, they don't necessarily say, oh, it's a woman. I'm less interested in.
I
don't think
like
so.
International, this is a very cosmopolitan market. So in many cases, people really don't know before they meet the artist if she's male or female, because some of the names are, you don't understand if it's male or female name.
Yeah, well, I don't agree at all, but this is my role not to agree. So that's also not a problem.
but
this is, it's one of the things that we need to confront, not only, you know, it's not only you as gallerist, it's one
it's
of
like
the problems that we need to confront as society, and becoming aware of it is an important thing. So of course, on the one hand, you don't make any difference, but there is difference.
And this difference
needs to be addressed, and it's a difficult thing. So many times, I remember I was working with a woman artist, very famous now, and then 15 years ago, she was saying, but I'm not anywhere. And I said, you need to be a little bit older. Like, you know, wait till you are 70 at least, or mid-70, then it becomes really, you're going to be so hot. And she's hot, because there is a time that you need to wait to prove an expertise and to prove the market as well. So it's an impressive question, but it's a real one, and it's really interesting. Mm-hmm. How, for example, I remember that we were producing the work of Anna Bogigian for the Documenta. This was an amazing work. Place in the second floor of the Fredericianum. Anna was not completely unknown. She did already had some solo shows. She was without any gallery support, and before Documenta, because she was completely in panic of dying, she was saying, I want this work going, you need to convince somebody to represent me. I cannot die without that. And it took such an effort. And it was only another woman that took that effort. So it is a question. So I don't, the polemic 12 o'clock question. And perhaps we can open it to the floor to make some questions from you as well. There is one.
Where? Who has a question?
Hi, I have a question for you, Chus, that you already kind of answered. And it's like we have the intuition that in Documenta, or maybe now in Istanbul, you counterbalance this imbalance that there's there, or this problematic, and you just put this example with this gender, with this woman. But I would like to ask for the implications, like the curatorial implications and the implications for the artist to grow in the future, and how did that happen with this artist in particular, or now in Istanbul through different gallery models?
You're asking about the woman representation in exhibitions?
No, like artists
you mean about financial support?
Exactly, that don't have this financial support, and how did it work differently than from traditional models, and how, because we had, as audience, we have the intuition that in Documenta or in Istanbul, you curators kind of did a counterbalanced effort to the dominant tendencies.
Yes, but I think the case of Documenta was, of course, completely different. I think it was a well-funded exhibition. The case of Istanbul is completely different, and I must say that it was an immense effort on the part of Caroline Christoph Bakargiev that curated that, to really use a very impressive network of both patrons and galleries to produce artworks that could not be produced, producing an exhibition that looks almost normal. So, which is very, very important because it gives the impression that it's a healthy context, that actually this could happen. The situation is so bad in many contexts that some biennials like the Istanbul may be in danger of disappearing, and this has really important implications. I think if a biennial like this at that verge of the Mediterranean, with the connections, with the flow of people, of artists, with the artistic and cultural community that visits these kind of exhibitions disappears, this would have consequences that are even difficult to explain or describe in at many levels. So it's of primordial importance, this, you know, this border that the biennial produce. In that sense, I must say that it's super important what the patrons and the galleries did, and I am very positive as well that really gallerists are doing an impressive effort to, which is new, to produce pieces and to convince people, to help curators to produce pieces. So there is able sides of it, and sometimes the results are, you know, more or less successful. But on the other hand, you need to find alliances because there is absolutely no other choices. I think the public money for such festivals, so to say, is disappearing. And also the political discourse and the ambience in which we are, even in Europe, which we are kind of affluent, is very antagonistic towards culture. So it's not only that you would not have the money, but it's also that we are creating an ambience where we are convincing our civil society, that's a bad thing. That's a bad thing to have this kind of meetings and gatherings, and that's kind of a new elitism, but it's not. But we are lacking really the intellectual power to reconstruct a language that would tell you, no, if these kind of venues disappear, if these moments disappear, if the multiplicity, if the nature of market versus public versus off space versus self-organized forces, this ecology, it makes sense if there is all of them, but if some start to disappear, then it's a monolithic culture. So I don't know if I answer, but yeah.
But it's also an interesting question on how to support an artist, or for a curator, how to invite an artist who is not represented by a gallery. What does it mean for this artist?
Yeah, but I think it's very important to cheat. I think, and that's the good thing of a good group of friends or patrons or alliances. Mm-hmm. Of course, you give the money, quote unquote, to support an artist that you collect. But you also know that part of this money goes to an artist that is unsupported. Right. And this is a conversation then that takes place, because that's the role that we all need to, I think we need to produce futures. Mm-hmm. And the futures are not in supporting what is already exactly actualized. So I think that this is exactly what probably happens in the galleries, because every time that you take another artist or you expand your program, you produce a future, so to say. Mm-hmm.
Well, I felt in Istanbul this was pretty interesting when I came that first evening, and I was bumping into really sophisticated collectors from all around the world. They were financing works. I haven't seen the biennial. I just arrived. I came to the dinner, and there they are from all over the world, museum people from all over the world, and they were financing the pieces there, and the host and all the Istanbul people involved, they were so proud of the situation, how they could build it, and that felt for me very good. So I came home, because we have Manifesta in Zurich, and the same evening in Zurich, Manifesta was trying to get the Zurich collectors together, and I missed it because of Istanbul, so I came back and said, you know, so now how was it? And you can imagine Zurich, lot of money, people were trying to get the money out of the Swissies, and that is difficult, you know, for such a situation. It's very, was very, very, very interesting. The cultural implications. And I'm very, very curious to see in Zurich if we get similar results with Jankowski and these people.
But it also has to do with taxation. I think it's true. It's true one thing. There is very charismatic, very responsible, very ethical people. Like Caroline is one of them, and I've been working with her, and I know what I'm talking about, able to convince a stone to commit. And this is exactly what we all need to do, because we need to commit. Without commitment of all levels, not going to happen. On the other hand, it's also true that we need to lobby and do governmental work. I think if you got, like in Spain, there is almost no way to get a penny from a private person. And the same in Switzerland sometimes, because of the taxes. I think the Americans, if you give $100,000, you deduct 97,000. So you pay in taxes for $100, you give in art $3,000. So if you are a multimillionaire, it really is important. Mm-hmm. So I'm not talking about that you need to copy in any way the American system. What I'm saying is that it's a conversation that is double. It's about personal commitment, but it's about state commitment as well. I think if you just put the bat, the taxes of buying art higher, then it's going to be difficult for the sector, because so all this conversation has to do also with how people feel about giving or not giving. So plus, it's a culture that we create collectively. Questions? Yeah, there's one.
How do you grow with the collector? Because you grow with the artist. Well, that's my question.
I think, like with the artist, also with the collector, it's very important to have a relationship. You have a commitment in the relationship. You have to be in a dialogue. Of course, you keep a collector posted about artistic developments of the artist that he's collecting. And I think for gallery, it's very important to grow with the entire network. It's very important to grow with your artists, but it's also important to grow with your collectors. And I think you can only manage that if you like keep in a dialogue and stay in touch with them.
One question. Do you work with art advisors?
It's almost not avoidable, so to say, because especially in the United States, art advisors became more and more and more important. And we've worked for a very long time with Thea Westreich, who kind of invented the art advisory system on a different level, which was a well-considered and reflected level. Now, I mean, if you're doing a fair, an art fair in New York or in Miami on the opening day, you have all the advisors and consultants going around the fair putting or trying to put a lot of pieces on hold until they've spoken with their clients, and then they come back to you, and it creates a very difficult situation. So we are not accepting this anymore. So we work only with a very few, with a handful of advisors with whom we have made good experiences, but we try to avoid, like, say, the big crowd.
Yeah, Thea Westreich is a very important art advisor from New York, and she's kind of known as well because she is one of the major supporters of the Whitney. So she donated her collection to the Whitney Museum that just opened. But I was also mentioning it because, for example, Thea was very important in New York to convince other people to collect. Mm-hmm. So she was kind of doing this kind of education of trying to promote art collecting as a good thing. So I think that we lack this kind of good model in Switzerland, for example, that it would be nice if somebody, because there is enough people that are interested, but sometimes they lack this kind of mediator in between the gallery, or don't you think?
It's culture. Well, you know, Switzerland is also very divided up. The French part is completely different than the German or the Italian part. So let's concentrate on the German part, which then is very close to Germany. And I think they're pretty individual. They pretty decide what they want to decide. They are less focused on an art advisor, like in America, maybe the people also work so hard and they are so insecure, they want to have the right thing. And also the art market is so big, so they have an offer for that service, which is in America much stronger than in Europe. And they talk and then take that office, that service, which I can understand. But of course, as I'm just coming back to the people-to-people relation we all enjoy as being a gallerist, I mean, that is the way to go. That's the way to go, and that's the way to grow. That's the way to get older. And, you know, everything has its time, especially we. And this is the moment when you have to hit it. And I have relationships where I had that moment now over 30 years with collectors, with artists, with the museum people. It's just clicks, you know. And buying art through an art advisor, okay, we can accept it, but if they would become the role model for us, you know, like they go around and make a pre-selection, it becomes really difficult for the real contact we enjoy. And we have to accept it because in the end, you know, the motivations, they're so, the variety of motivations of buying art today, it's beyond my hands here. And this is going to grow if you go internet and all that stuff. It's hard. I mean, it's a way to steer with your personality. The great thing in the end, after 30 years having a gallery, is that you have maybe something to say. And I love it if I can say, this is 200,000, because this is a really interesting work. You may not have done your homework, but this piece of art is historically interesting, and this is a historically interesting artist. Go and make your homework and then come back. Because, you know, people say, oh, it's very expensive. They never heard about the artist.
But we are probably kind of, you know, at the beginning of a major transformation. Imagine if I would say to my grandmother that you would have, you know, relationships via Tinder, she would probably faint. But now, it was an article yesterday in a German newspaper saying that, no, it was in the Swiss newspaper, that was even more interesting. 40% of the sexual relationships happening in the German-speaking part of Switzerland are happening via Tinder. So it's not inimaginable that you would have a gallery Tinder, that people are gonna go for this kind of digital or, you know, disengaged relationship which puts aside the personal, even if it seems unthinkable, you know, because it seems that having sex and buying art is the most personal thing in the world, but it's probably not difficult to see it coming.
What was the question?
Yeah, if you see the, you know, the Tinder of buying art coming, you know, an application that just puts you with the works that you could actually have available for a certain price, and you could click on it and have them without really knowing, or this kind of...
I can see that in the future.
I told you.
Strangely enough, I can see that there maybe goes in that direction if I see how people have their relationship and breaking up their relationship through an SMS, say goodbye. You know, you're laughing, but it's the truth. I mean, come on, it's, and why not with art? You know, you have the money, evening, 10 o'clock, you go through and say, ah, interesting, bought.
What was the name of this art fair, which only took place in the internet? There was like an art fair, remember that, 5 years ago? That was only a virtual internet art fair.
Oh, I learned. Where,
yeah, galleries participated. They had a stand, a digital stand. Yep. They installed works in the digital stand, and everything was for sale only online. And you were in chat rooms with collectors. I think it's a terrible model, but I'm also totally old school. So, but these are tendencies.
Yeah.
So, this is a question from the floor.
Is it working? Okay. Hi, I'm Daniela. I have a question. We are talking about different gallery models, and I'm wondering, could we also think about different system within the established gallery model? So, for example, that the bigger galleries support the smaller ones, because now everyone has the same focus, growing with your artist, but maybe we can also discuss a bit, because yesterday it was just a 5 minutes topic, that there could be maybe also in the future ways that bigger galleries support the smaller ones. Mm-hmm. Instead of everyone trying the same traject.
I think you can look at this question from two points. At the moment, it's rather the case that bigger galleries are exploiting smaller galleries. The pressure from all these mega galleries towards mid-level or smaller galleries is really high because young galleries build up an artist career. And then if this career is successful, if this artist is successful, there's a high chance that one of these mega galleries is coming to ask to represent this artist because the mega gallery has 5, 6, 7, 8 branches all over the world and they need a lot of, let's say, commercial gods to sell. And so this is one point of view, that it's more towards an exploitation and not so much about supporting a younger gallery. But there are also potential models that that there are real collaborations between, let's say, a bigger gallery with the smaller galleries, that a bigger gallery shares an artist with a smaller gallery, and like with his financial possibilities, then rather supports the artist together with the smaller gallery who is not able probably to do that. And so it can grow healthy in a collaboration, but I haven't seen this model so often so far.
But sometimes you also galleries exchange, like it's also true that sometimes you come to an agreement with another gallery and you exhibit your artist in another gallery in another place, so these kind of collaborations are already happening.
This is sometimes we do it personally, like I saw a little piece in a Spanish art fair and there was a young man who turned into an art dealer. I saw the piece, I bought it. It was the first sale. After I bought it, three other colleagues bought three pieces because they saw me buying it. I helped that young gallery. I knew what I was doing. I had my son with him and said, watch what's going to happen.
Victor, can you travel more in Spain?
Pardon me?
Can you travel more in Spain?
I'm since 25 years in your lovely country. I love it there. But I know the problems. And as Jochen said, I mean, this is a serious situation for every gallerist starting, having a certain level, having done 10 years developing a career of an artist in today's world. This is really very, very serious situation. It's only to maneuver probably with the personal relationship you build up with this artist. If he wants to go, you have to leave him go. You cannot do anything against it. No contract, nothing will help you. Nothing. Because you would have to, he wants it.
Last question from the floor.
My question is, how do you balance support for individualism with support for collectivism?
I don't understand the question.
How do you balance support both from curators and collectors for individual artists with support for collective movements of artists or of groups of artists or of groups of ideas?
How do you
balance support?
Balance. It's a question
for
the galleries.
For the whole, for everyone in the room.
From my practice, it's always very interesting and complicated, actually, to work with collectives. It's this is the one thing is for sure that that the collective is not really the model which is doing well financially usually. because it happens to us a couple of times. We've been working with groups, and then at the very end, if you even succeed to produce the work, to sell the work, then this is really like a, this is kind of incredible practical moment that you, then you divide this money, you make a share. At the very end, there's a little, really little rest to the individual artist in the collective. So for example, this is also kind of very interesting and something I was thinking about time to time, that in Poland, after the whole transformation in the 90s, that there was somehow incredible run of the artists even to work individually. So all the idea of the collective thinking, collective working was somehow abandoned suddenly. I think it has a lot of to do with the idea of the neoliberal economy and that everyone is working for himself. And suddenly we notice after like a 10 or 15 years that there is no more art collectives and there are no artisan spaces because this new generation of artists was really more interested to work individually with the galleries because there was the hope that the market can help them to establish their position. Yeah, so this is the case of this kind of new economies. Then everyone is in a very competitive position. This is, I think, somehow reflects on all what we are discussing today, that this, we are really living in a system which is very and more competitive. So even like we've been discussing this question of personal relationships with the collectors and also the working with the advisors. This is also like it's happening more and more that we need to have a mediator to access the certain collectors or people that are potentially buyers because they have so many other options to do. You know, they can buy another house and there is so much, you know, so much competition in the business, not necessarily in visual arts. There is so much offer to steal their money that we are somehow at the very end and we don't really have these tools anymore. So then we need another persons, another tools, even like a social media to approach them or even like advisors. So this is, I mean, it's not the part of the answer or the question of collectives, but...
Well, I worked, they were still alive, and I still represent now this state. I worked with the Canadian collective General Idea since almost 30 years, and of course they were a kind of pioneering situation at the time. There were very few artist collectives. In my experience, they organized themselves amongst them, so there was always one guy who sort of looked that the food is on the table in a way. He was the business aspect. And of course, you had to feed the three. You had to try to manage in the whole situation. And in the very, very end of today, I must say it's probably a very difficult situation as a collective, and that's probably why less and less and less today is possible. At the beginning, you may start because you share ideas, and then it becomes too competitive to survive in all the situation today. Even with an artistic ideas, it becomes very, very, very complicated.
Yeah. I think that unfortunately we need to stop here. But I would like to thank you for sharing the stage with me, and you really very much for coming and listening to us. So enjoy your day. The fair is open.